Hi, welcome to the Trauma and Resilience Podcast. I'm Ricky Robertson. Today, our guest is Leilani Sabzalian, who is an Indigenous scholar, researcher, and educator at the University of Oregon. Leilani is also the author of the book Indigenous Children's Survivance in Public Schools. Leilani, welcome to the program.
Thanks, Ricky. Thanks for having me. Chamai, hui Leilani Sabzalian, Eugene, Oregon, Misushlianga. I just greet you in Aleutic, which is my heritage language. I'm Aleutic. My family's from Chignik, Alaska. I'm here in Eugene, Oregon, where I was born and raised.
Wonderful. Thank you. I'm joining you from San Francisco, the land of the Ohlone peoples. It's a honor that we get to have this conversation today. I'm a big fan of your work, and I would love if you could just briefly describe the work that you do for folks that are listening or viewing today.
Yeah, I'd be happy to. So I live and work in Kalapuya Ilihi, which are the traditional homelands of Kalapuya people. So I would say a big part of the work that I do is embodying responsibilities. Even though I am Aleutic or Alaska Native, I live and work in Oregon, which are Indigenous homelands. And so I try to teach and cultivate learning environments that are respectful and have a sense of responsibility to the Indigenous peoples here.
I love that. It's so impressive to me that your work operates at so many different levels, from curriculum to actually working with folks that are going to become teachers and educators, and then providing professional development to educators and working at the state level as well. I'm very curious. I read your book, Indigenous Children's Survivance in Public Schools, and I'd be curious if you would talk to us a little bit about what inspired you to write that, and just also kind of unpack for folks who might not be familiar with the term survivance, just what that means as well.
I was a PhD student engaging in research, but I led a Native youth group in the district, and we were engaging in all these incredible activities. And, you know, we ended up creating a Native youth center, and I was just feeling really good about the curriculum and the work we were doing as a community. But youth really just kept sharing experiences about being or feeling kind of betrayed in their classrooms, or times that they felt unsupported or even harmed by their peers or by their teachers even. And so I started paying attention to those stories. And I started writing about them as my dissertation research, to really draw attention to the way that Indigenous education, educators often think that's what happens in the Indian education programs. That's what happens in the Native youth centers. And that's what happens in tribal schools on reservations, rather than thinking about Indigenous education is a responsibility and a practice that takes place in all public schools, wherever there are Indigenous students. And so I wrote the book, which contains stories as a way to help kind of draw attention to the colonialism that Indigenous youth were experiencing in public schools. But that term you brought up, survivance, that was really a key part of the book and what I was trying to pay attention to. Because, you know, colonialism can be kind of the defining story of Indigenous education or Indigenous students or just Indigenous people's experiences. And survivance is a term coined by White Earth scholar Gerald Visner. And it combines the words survival and resistance, though it means so much more than those two words kind of together. But it's a word that really like encapsulates spirited resistance and Indigenous people's active sense of presence. You know, the way that in spite of colonial structures or institutions or curricula or pedagogy, we remain who we are. We defy those systems. We assert ourselves. We have this continual kind of spirited resistance and presence. And so the stories I wrote in that book draw attention to that dynamic, you know, that Indigenous youth resist their own oppression in really kind of nuanced and artful and creative and sometimes courageous ways, right?
Can you think of a specific, and I'm sure that there are many, many, many that might come to mind, but any stories or examples to give folks who are listening an understanding of what survivance might look like in a classroom or a school?
In the book, I write about various students and their experiences with curriculum or teaching practices that feel like they erase or marginalize them, and the ways students kind of actively resist those practices and then center their own kind of experiences and understanding. So the first story in the book follows, one student, Zeke, who is 7 years old. He's the second grader, and his teacher reads a book to the class that has pilgrims and Indians. And, he doesn't like the way the Indians in the book are portrayed. And so he raises his hand and he tells that to the teacher that not all Native people wear feathers or paint their faces. In fact, those are for special times, and feathers are for people who earn them. And so to me, that's an example not only of him resisting this kind of Eurocentric and whitewash narrative that his teacher's, reading to the class, but also asserting his own knowledge. Like, he has an understanding of paint. He has an understanding of feathers, and what the book is trying to tell him is not his experience, So he's communicating his knowledge. In another example, I talk about a student, Celeste, who, in our youth group, we did this activity around cultural appropriation to help Native youth really develop this kind of critical literacy and vocabulary to understand and critique the widespread practice of cultural appropriation and people dressing up as Indians for Halloween. And so she felt inspired by this activity and proposed it as this art assignment for one of her classes. And her teacher really shut down her idea and said, "That's not important. Pay attention to more important issues like women's issues." Celeste processed that experience in the group with us, and she decided not to do the project in class. She just did a project that got her the grade. And in the summer camp I was teaching for Native youth, that's where she did her project, And I view that as this practice of survivance too, because she didn't let the teacher define her work, right? She did it on her own terms and on her own time. And she should have been doing that project with the support of her teacher, right? But instead she did it in spite of her teacher. She did it in a context where she felt comfortable. She drew this beautiful representation of Indigenous women and the stereotypes all around them that Indigenous women are navigating, and assertions of visual sovereignty and why misrepresentation and cultural appropriation matter. And all her peers and her teacher never got to benefit from that, right? But she didn't just close off. She did it in this other context. So she still asserted her presence and her priorities.
When I think about the story of Zeke, I think about, as well as the story of Celeste, I'm thinking about also in what could the teacher have done differently, or how could the teacher have thought ahead of time about the story that they chose to read, or how they responded to Zeke or Celeste in the moment. And so I guess I'm wondering, what kind of suggestions do you have for educators, how they can identify practices that are harmful to Native students and not engage in those practices, but also really respond to the lived experience of the students in their classrooms so that when those perspectives are shared, they don't shut it down and say, well, you got to do the project, or, or disregard what Zeke has said and just keep going. So what suggestions do you have for educators on ways that they can be more affirming and also identify and prevent as well as address practices that may be harmful to students, especially Native students?
Yeah, that's a great question. First I would, step back before offering suggestions for educators and say that the ways that we prepare teachers really needs to be transformed. Like, we need institutional commitments to teacher preparation that involves rigorous engagement with Indigenous studies. Like, it's not an accident that teachers are unprepared. So that's my first kind of answer. And there's states, you know, Washington passed legislation that now requires curriculum on tribal history and sovereignty in all teacher prep programs, which I think is a model to follow. And then, of course, you know, I'm in the work of preparing Indigenous teachers. So I think we really need to work on and sustain those pathways. But in terms of individual teachers, you know, I think the first is just recognizing that colonialism is baked in to the fabric of schooling. So when we realize colonialism is endemic, then we start to become sensitized and look for the ways that it operates and it surfaces so that we have this ability to kind of detect and interrupt and counter and then come up with other alternatives. So, you know, in the story with Zeke, for example, I talk about how curriculum is often tacitly rooted in Eurocentrism, right? The idea that curriculum kind of faces West, right? Exploration, expansion. These are particular kind of Eurocentric ways of understanding curriculum. But, you know, Indigenous perspectives might say, oh, that's invasion, right? That's encroachment. That's not expansion. That's dispossession. So thinking really critically about the foundations upon which social studies curriculum, for example, is based is really important. And then really infusing and grounding our work in Indigenous perspectives and Indigenous studies, I think, is important. Both the teacher who was working with Zeke and the teacher working with Celeste, I think we have to have affirming views of students, and in particular, Indigenous students, right? Affirming views that believe in their capacity, that believe they are brilliant and that they have knowledge to share, and then humility on our part to listen, right? To listen deeply and to be impacted by what youth tell us and to be transformed by that and feel a sense of responsibility. In the story with Celeste, I talk about the teacher who missed moments, but I also implicate myself. You know, there was curriculum that I was organizing that felt alienating to Celeste, and I didn't realize it until after I was interviewing her for to write the story. And that was humbling, you know, like I could, you know, I'm an Indigenous scholar. I am trained in Indigenous studies. I've been an educator. I have a love of Native youth and a fierce commitment to Indigenous education. And I created a context where she felt alienated and she felt less than as a Native person, right? And the difference is we stay in relationship and I feel responsible when she shared that information with me. And, you know, it came out because of our interview, which actually, you know, one of the implications I take from that story is like, how do we create kind of feedback loops for our students to give us feedback on the way our teaching is impacting them?
The way that your work highlights the power of stories and of listening and also relationships. And like you talked about in that relationship with Celeste, like you stayed in relationship. So you were able to hear something that was probably maybe painful to hear from Celeste, but also really important. And so honoring that relationship and those opportunities that we have as educators to say, okay, now that I know better, I can do better. And and I don't have to get stuck in shame or blame. I can now shift my practices and really look for ways to co-create this learning experience with my students. In talking, especially with youth, did you find themes that came up around connections between your research and topics like trauma and resilience?
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't often frame my work in terms of trauma or resilience, but I really, you know, frame my work in terms of colonialism and survivance. And that's intentional for me, you know, trauma, particularly intergenerational and historical trauma, are real and devastating experiences that our communities deal with, ongoing legacies that we grapple with. But the way I kind of have seen trauma get taken up as a framework, it individualizes the idea of harm. And for me, colonialism you know, it reminds us that it's a structural harm mm-hmm. that we're enduring in society and schools, and also that it's ongoing, mm-hmm. right? And that's also why I'm drawn to survivance as opposed to resilience. I'm compelled by survivance because, you know, Gerald Fisner says, victimry leaves Native youth with little to imagine, right? Mm-hmm. And I think survivance is this idea of spirited resistance. And, you know, just like we inherit trauma, we inherit that spirited resistance. Mm-hmm. And it's an intergenerational inheritance. Mm-hmm. And it's our legacy as Indigenous people. And I want Indigenous youth to feel like they can tap into that legacy of agency and creativity and courage and presence. And I think recognizing colonialism as a collective and ongoing harm, you know, and survivance as a collective and ongoing inheritance, really inform kind of interventions or educational practices that are also collective in nature. I don't want survivance to be viewed as, you know, my argument for grit.
Exactly. You know,
where we're just coping students with skills to withstand harmful structures of school. Instead of grit, let's cope them with survivance. That's not how I want my work to be framed. And there's, you know, there's some Indigenous scholars who do beautiful work with that. Helen Thomas, she's a Hunkpapa Lakota educator, and she also works at the Office of Indian Education in Arizona. And she does work on restorative practices and their roots within Indigenous knowledge systems, and talks about, look, if we're going to talk about trauma-informed education, we need to think about strength-based approaches to that
that
are rooted in the collective strengths of our communities, our language, our cultures, our knowledge systems. And so that's kind of where I situate my work.
Yeah, beautiful. I worry about ways that trauma is individualized and that people don't look at the collective health of a community. They don't look at the generational wisdom and resilience and power of that community. I guess a question I have next is for educators that are listening, and these are maybe for them new topics, or maybe they're actually in a teacher training program right now, right? They could be, you know, thinking about becoming an educator. What resources would you recommend for them to learn more about some of the topics that we've talked about? Are there any that have been, you know, personally enriching for you that you'd say, check out this book or this resource?
Red Pedagogy, Native American Social and Political Thought by Sandy Grande. She's a Quechua scholar. That has been foundational for me. And I just believe learning happens through the labor and the process of rigorously engaging with theories and ideas and critically reflecting on and examining your own practice. And teachers don't spend enough time engaging Indigenous studies, right? They can't. When they're in-service teachers, it's really hard to take the time and energy because teachers' jobs are so difficult.
Yeah.
Right. And so when it comes to in-service professional development, for example, I'm given, let's say, 90 minutes to kind of pack anti-colonial work into this little PD, this bite-sized PD. But Sandy Grande's book, Red Pedagogy, it really helps you rethink the foundations of U.S. schooling through the lenses of colonialism and indigeneity. You know, and she invites us to rethink the democratic aims of school. Right. And look at the ways that schooling and the nation state have undermined Indigenous sovereignty. She has us look at really the deep structures of colonialism. She talks about the deep, deep levels, like the sense of individualism we cultivate in students, right? The sense of separation from and superiority over land and all the communities that land sustains. Right? The separation of spirit and reason, right? And this inherent belief that progress is better. And so I think that is a foundational text I would recommend for people to be really engaging in teacher education programs. And there's some great new books out. For practicing teachers, there's Indian Education for All by John Hopkins. He's a scholar, and he really looks at efforts in Montana for an Indian Education for All. And the ways this beautiful Indigenous-led initiative has just fallen short in practice because we haven't done the transformative work to kind of decolonize the systems in which we're trying to infuse Indigenous pedagogy and curriculum. And so he asks us to kind of, for teachers to desettle the assumptions that we bring to the table, really rethink our reliance on Western knowledge systems, and so we can create contexts and conditions that respect Indigenous knowledge systems.
Wonderful. And we'll make sure to put the links to any of the resources that Leilani recommends attached to this episode for folks who are currently listening or viewing. Leilani, I have a question. We've talked about some of the ways that colonialism can show up in the classroom, but I'm also curious, are there examples that you've seen of ways that educators have engaged in culturally affirming practices that have honored the well-being, the lived experience, and the identities of Native students?
Yeah, I have lots of examples. One really beautiful example comes from Kanu Oka'aina, a New Century Public Charter School in Hawaii. And this is a Native Hawaiian-based charter school where Hawaiian language, Hawaiian values, Hawaiian culture are embedded into the content and the processes of curriculum. The students are learning on the land in Waipio Valley, or they're learning on the water in Kauaihai Harbor, in the canoes. Instead of how so many schools have adopted kind of the be safe, be respectful, be responsible model, mm-hmm. They have Hawaiian values guiding kind of student conduct. So mm-hmm. Hawaiian values mm-hmm. are at the heart of how they're nurturing up young students. And not all of the students are Hawaiian, which I find really beautiful, right? The school's on Hawaiian lands, but everyone is committed in that school to perpetuating Native Hawaiian culture and values. So I think that's, there's so many examples of Indigenous-led charter schools, but also Indigenous-led public schools,
yes.
where even if people aren't teaching in those contexts, we can learn so much from the way they think about education, from the values that they hold. Helen Thomas actually is that Hunkapapa Lakota educator I was just telling you about. She does the most beautiful work on restorative practices, and she taught in a public school that was mixed Native and non-Native students. And she says, nurturing community, sustaining community, and repairing community. She uses Indigenous knowledge systems to set up that process. And so much curriculum afterward flows from that because she has set up the conditions for rich learning, right? A community context where students feel kind of invested in one another and in the classroom learning community. And then I think so many other examples really stem from like caring deeply, loving children.
Yes.
Loving Native children, loving yes. children, caring deeply about them, mm-hmm. and then creating contexts where Native youth and all youth care about what they're learning about. Mm-hmm. Like kids' relationship to learning is incredible. Mm-hmm. Like when kids want to learn something, you can't stop them.
That's incredible. I there's so much in what you just shared that is so important to consider, the ways that we build relationships, that we foster, repair, and sustain community. And I also think that there's ways that even educators who are not Native or don't work in schools with Native students can, like you said, learn from Indigenous ways of knowing and teaching and valuing that can help to guide and support their learning community. Even a teacher who is teaching in a school that's got, kind of the safe, respectful, responsible expectations, they can sit down with their students and say, what does respect look like and sound like to you? And here's what respect looks like and sounds like for me. And let's come up with a collective definition and agreements around what respect looks like and sounds like and feels like in this classroom, right? And so there's ways that we can learn from Indigenous values and Indigenous ways of knowing and teaching.
You know, Indigenous educational principles are just good grounding principles for public education. You know, I just think it's human nature, for example, to learn through stories and storytelling. And so, you know, Michelle Jacob, my colleague, she has the most beautiful set of stories that she's written, which we use with teachers, but also kids in public schools. I'm sharing that because I think we can all learn from stories, right? Any kid can learn from stories, and we can throw Indigenous stories in there. Right. But storytelling as curriculum, storytelling as a process of learning, those are valuable. Or the land, right?
Yes.
Like land-based learning is just a very natural way of learning. And so thinking about how to infuse land education into what you're doing, is another kind of Indigenous guiding principle, I think, that can benefit all kids.
Absolutely. Everything you shared about storytelling, time in nature, I mean, these are things that we know also in the world of trauma-informed care that are incredibly important protective factors that support the well-being of the whole child. I have one last question, Leilani, which is, what is one way that your work has changed you?
I would say on one level, like having a dedicated time and energy spent reading Indigenous studies scholarship has been so liberating for me as an Indigenous person, like as an Indigenous educator, as someone reflecting on my own experiences and processing them as an Indigenous student, right? Now as an adult. So study has been really liberatory for me. It's helped me just kind of lift up some of the burdens I've felt growing up and, you know, take them up off my back and really locate problems, not with me, but with these systems I've been trying to navigate as a kid or as a young adult. In my work with Native youth, I've been transformed by like the vibrance, the fresh perspectives, the innovation, the creativity. I'm talking about Native youth, but the kids bring, right? Like I love working with young people, and I think we should all have young people who are mentors. Like working with youth just changes me. And so that process has been really transformative because I have my own experiences as an adult, you know, and reflecting on my life. But that's not always the experiences of young people. Mm-hmm. So staying in relationship with young people reminds me not to kind of overwrite their stories and experiences of the world with my own, right? Just to set up a relationship where we can share stories and learn from one another. I've learned so much working with an elder, right? In an intergenerational learning community. It just makes me realize, why aren't all learning spaces intergenerational? Like, why are we separating kids by age and then bracketing it off young people from elders? Like, we learn so much from elders, and elders learn so much from young people, right? So just, I think that other aspect of my work now, having a space that's kind of elder guided, has been really transformative for me and helping me rethink like what public education systems could look like if more elders were involved.
Wow. Leilani, it has been an honor to speak with you and to learn from you. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me, Kuyana.
The Trauma and Resilience series is made possible by a partnership between the National Education Association and WETA. For more information, please visit adlit.org/trauma. Trauma and Resilience is available on YouTube and on every major podcast platform. If you like what you've heard, please subscribe to the whole series so you won't miss an episode.